And we were created in the image and likeness of God. We had all the knowledge there was to have. We had all the love there was to have. We had all the peace, all the prosperity there was to have. It's ever been created, never will be created. And yet there was a part of our mind that stepped off and said, yeah, but you know what? If we eat that thing, we'll be as God. We'll have the knowledge that God has, and he can't mess with us anymore. In fact, we'll mess with him. And so that part of our mind became our human consciousness. It became our ego. It became perspective, is another name for it. Okay? We have perceptions of things from that part of our mind that obviously is just the opposite of what God created us as. Okay? So in other words, to say it nicely, this part of our mind is insane because it thinks everything backwards from what we truly and really are. Okay? But we listen to it all the time. How do you know you listen to it? When you hear your voice going, ah, that ain't right, and this is that, and I'm going to tell them that I can fix it this way. Oh, you're so sweet. That voice is that insane voice in that part of our mind. The other part of our mind that God created and what we truly and really are goes, hey, Greg, I love you. Really? Yeah. Anything you want, any desire you have, it's yours because I love you. And this part of my mind goes, okay, what's the deal? Okay, there's something, what have I got to pay for this? There's a trick to it because this side of my mind says everything is an attack because that's what it came out of. It attacked our God mind. And so it says everything has to be an attack. I have to get something out of it or it just doesn't work. It doesn't exist. Now, I'm telling you all that. I've told you this before. But what we need to understand is how does our mind function today? Well, we go inside and we look for what we want to see, and then we look out and we see it. And we call that truth. We call it reality. It's what we created. Now, we can decide which mind we want to create with. Our God mind, or our human consciousness, our ego, our perception, if you will. Now, you can argue with me about that. I have all kinds of degrees in psychology and stuff. But the point is that that's how our mind really works, okay? We think we look out here and observe everything, and then we decide what's correct, what's proper, where does this fit, and it doesn't happen at all. What happens is we go inside, we decide what I want to see, what is reality, and then we project it out onto the world, and that's exactly what we see. Nothing more, nothing less. So what we consider to be reality is not reality at all. Of course, a miracle says that which is real is cannot be threatened. That which is unreal doesn't exist. And therein, or herein, lies the peace of God. Okay? Everything that God created is real. Can't be destroyed. Can't be done away with. So you, me, as individual expressions of God, is real. That can't be destroyed. That can't go anywhere. All the other stuff that comes from our human perception, our human consciousness, our human ego, is all made up BS. And it changes all the time. In fact, our ego has gotten so good at it, we can hold thoughts that we create our reality from that are just the opposite of each other, and it makes sense. How insane is that? It's totally insane. It's completely crazy. But yet we buy it all the time. Okay, when we stop and start to question, what mind is it am I using to see this world the way I want it, and create my world the way I want to see it? Because remember, we're co-creators. God created us in his image and likeness. God is a creator. So he made us co-creators. That part can't be destroyed. It can't go away. That's real. So we have to decide, what do I want to experience here? Now, when we came into this world, the idea of it, we couldn't wait to jump into a fertilized egg and come into this experience. We thought, my goodness, what fun this would be. Oh, the good things we could do and the fun we could have and the joy that I could experience. My goodness, I can't wait. And we got here, we had a blank mind. We didn't have human perception yet. We didn't have human consciousness yet. We didn't have an ego yet. We just cried and wet our diapers and ate and did those kind of things. And over time, we learned all the insane perceptions that this part of our mind has. We learned it very good because we learned it from those people around us, parents, relatives, siblings, friends, teachers, ministers, angels, whoever. We learned all of this stuff. And we say, well, that's because somebody taught me that. I didn't mean to learn that stuff because somebody shoved it in my face and said, this is reality. But we had to make the decision to accept it. Once we accept something, it becomes reality for us. So we accepted all the ideas that life is just tough. Life is unfair. The world is against me. Well, not so much the world, just my friends and family and everybody I know. And we believe that. So we go inside and we say, well, what does that mean to me? And then we go, well, since I can't really trust them, I'll keep them away, keep them at arm's length. And any dealings I have with them, I'll always make sure that it's to my benefit more than theirs. Now, yeah, they can get some benefit out of it, but I get the premium benefit. Because otherwise, why would I even be involved? Why would I even want something to do with those people or that situation if I'm not going to benefit from it? Okay, so we got to the point now where we get some idea of how the mind works a little bit. What I really wanted to talk to you about was about healing and about sickness. And that's a tough one because I thought about it when I decided I was going to lay it out in a nice, easy way for you to understand. I realized that I'll probably say some things that your conscious mind, your ego, your perception is going to go, no way, this guy is completely off his rocker. He's nuts. Okay? And that's okay. You can think that if you want. But all I ask is that just take some of these ideas and think about it. Think about the possibility, that's all. Because when you want to make a major change in your life, God says, the Christ mind says, if you just crack the door open that much, I'll push it open for you. I'll open that door and pour on you a blessing so great that your mind can't handle it. You'll be so overwhelmed and so overjoyed. But you, me, we have to crack that door. And cracking that door sometimes means thinking things that you've never thought before or thinking of things in a way that you've never thought of them before. Okay? Sickness and the acceptance of sickness is a decision made by the mind. It's an election. You say, well, this, I got a bum leg here. I didn't want that. No, I said the acceptance of illness or sickness or injury or whatever is our decision. We make it with our mind. Why do we do that? How do we do that? Remember I said we go inside, we decide how we want to see things, and that's how we see it. Well, go back, and I'm going to jump a little bit here now. Jump back to the Garden of Eden when we told God, give me that freaking apple, I'm going to eat it, and I'm going to be as smart as you, and I will put you down. You will no longer control me or be over me. Okay? And then we stepped back and we went, oh my God, who did I just say that to? He is going to kill me. He's going to punish me. He's going to destroy me. for wanting to do such a thing. And when we make that decision to accept illness and sickness, okay, that's a slam against God. It's putting him in his place. See, because if I can't do battle with you straight up and win, I'll do the next best thing. Before you can hurt me, God, I'll hurt myself. Now I've taken your power away, God. You think you're so omniscient, so all-knowing, all-powerful, yet I can create an illness and accept it. And now I've taken your power away. Now that's pretty twisted, isn't it? Where does that come from? The twisted part of our thinking, from our human consciousness, from our perception, from our ego. So how do we get to the point? But let me give you a couple of real quick examples so that you know I'm not completely off my rocker. How many of you ever heard of the placebo effect? Okay. How many of you ever read or seen anything about anorexia? Okay, you're familiar with it. How many of you ever heard of or had experience with multiple personalities? Okay, stop and think about that for a second. Each one of those involves what? The mind, not the body. Your body, my body, does not tell us who and what we are and what the reality is. But we do it all the time. We let this twisted part of us tell us that the body's in charge, it's in control, because that's what you are. You're this body, aren't you? You gotta be. Because it's reality. That's flesh and blood. That's real. That's reality. It's an illusion of reality is what it is. But beside that, it's the mind that makes the decisions, not the body. But our human consciousness, our human ego has it flipped the other way. We get up in the morning, my legs hurt me. I guess that's not going to be a good day, you know, because it probably won't get better. As the day goes on, it'll get worse. You know, experience tells me that, okay? I could go to a doctor and have him do a whammy on it or give me a pill, which will affect my body, and therefore, my body will tell my mind I'm okay. It doesn't work that way. Now, we can numb the mind into thinking that it happens, and that's what happens with the placebo, isn't it? What happens with the placebo? You get a sugar pill, and whatever illness, sickness you have goes away. Why? Is there any property in that? No. Is there any property in the body to do that? No. The property is up here in our God mind, not our ego mind, not our human consciousness, not our perception of reality. Okay? But we can use this side to twist it around and actually create and accept sickness and illness. So I guess what I wanted to tell you was there are ways that we can get around that. And the way to get around it is you have to be willing to listen to your God mind and let the other stuff fade away. Well, how do you do that? Well, there's ways you can do it. But obviously working with somebody is a good way, because oftentimes when I sit and I try to talk with my God self, my ego jumps in there and says, oh, what are you, some kind of dummy? That is not true. That won't work. Come on. Get serious. Oh, yeah, but it will. I know if I pray hard enough, if I meditate on it. Oh, come on now. That's just completely hogwash. That ain't going to work. Next thing I know, I'm arguing with my ego, and my ego's arguing with itself. My God mind got left on the shelf somewhere, and my ego mind is just having a ball. Arguing back and forth. Anorexia. Okay. How can a person that's rail thin, on the verge of death, look in the mirror and say, God, I still got some fat here. Look how fat my thighs are. How can that be? And that's what they see. Why? Because they went inside and said, what do I want to see? And they created it. Now, you say, why would your mind do that? Well, stop and think about it. That's the ego mind, right? The one that's insane? The one that can't think properly? The one that has it out for you? That's the mind that you're letting make those decisions. And so it goes in and it says, yeah, you're probably too fat. You know, 65 pounds, you're too fat. And they look out in a mirror and that's what they see. They see themselves fat. Does it have anything to do with the body? No. Nope. The mind. Okay. All sickness, illness, the acceptance of it is controlled by our mind. I know that. I've worked with people over the years. Some of you know I'm a hypnotherapist. And I've worked with people in hypnosis, which is a natural state of mind, by the way. All of you have been in and out. Some of you have been in the state of hypnosis while I was talking. Okay, because I looked out and you're... Okay, it's a natural state of mind. But what it is, it's a state of mind where we leave out the conscious filter, the conscious ego, the conscious perceptions. We leave those out, and then we talk directly to the subconscious mind. And when we say something to it and give it a suggestion, it goes, if you say so. Okay, so if I give a suggestion, I say, I want you to be sick, I want you to be so nauseous you can't stand it, you'll get up and hardly make it to the bathroom. Guess what they're going to do? They'll be sick. Okay? But if I give them a suggestion that what you're experiencing is just a part of your mind that's playing tricks on you, playing games with you, and that no longer need be, then guess what happens? They begin to heal. Or they become healed completely. Am I a healer? No. Do my hands heal? No. Do my words heal? No. Healing is something that is what you are in your God mind. You have 100% health all the time. So how could I do something? How could I give you something? How could I use my hands to get something from you that you already had and already have? I can't. Makes no sense, does it? All I can say is that if you really want to look at yourself and see it in a different perspective and work at removing perception, moving back towards your God mind, talk to somebody. Call me. Talk to a friend. Talk to somebody that can help you in doing that. And you say, that's an awful big job, man. I've spent the better part of how many decades now, you know, trying to mess up my mind. Well, it's as easy as changing your mind. That's all. Now, you change your mind and you start operating from God's mind, you're going to get things pop up from your perspective, your perceptions, from your ego, from your human conscience. And it's going to be standing back there, Greg, you know that's wrong. Okay, that doesn't work. So that's why it's nice to have fellowship like this when we can meet with people, our friends, on a regular basis, and know that my heart, my interest is yours too. Because we're all one. That God mind is all one. We're just individualized expressions of it, right? So we're all one. We really are. We're just dressed in different bodies before, but. And that's a hard concept for the human ego to accept. It doesn't want to, because it says, if I accept that, there's no reason for me to be around. And so the ego fights it tooth and nail. It doesn't want any part of you knowing who you really are. Okay? You can't change your mind by changing your behavior. Ask anybody that's tried to lose weight, stop smoking, get rid of alcoholism or drug abuse and that. Yeah, you can try for a while. You know, I'm not going to eat any of that food and then. But what happens? You go right back to it. You have to change your mind. And when you do, changing your behavior is easy. It just happens automatically. Why? Because we go inside, we see what we want to see, and we project it out, and that's our reality. So when you operate from this side and you say, I want to lose weight, I want to stop smoking, I want to quit drinking, I want to quit drugs, I want to quit looking at pretty women, whatever it is. Okay? You caught me on that one. Whatever it is happens easily, effortlessly. when we change our mind first. So work on that. Work on changing your mind. And know that Spirit, God, love, ask only one thing from us. And that's to be happy. And if we ask, we will receive anything and everything we need to be joyous and happy. And that, my friends, is the truth. Thank you. Thank you. Well, with that being said, let's take up our offering while we enjoy another solo by our wonderful, talented, and beautiful soloist.
This song was written after September 11th in commemoration of the firefighters and the first responders who died on that day. It's called To Where You Are. Who can say for certain? Maybe you're still here. I feel you all around me, your memory so clear. Deep in the stillness, I can hear you speak. You're still an inspiration. Can it be that you are my forever love? And you are watching over me from up above. Fly me up to where you are, beyond the distant stars. Upon tonight to see you smile, if only for a while to know you're there. A breath away is not far to where you are. Are you gently sleeping here inside my dream? And isn't faith believing all power can't be seen? As my heart holds you just one beat away, I cherish all you gave me every day, 'cause you are my forever. Watching me from up above, and I believe that angels breathe, and that love will live on and never leave. Fly me up to where you are, beyond the distant stars.
That's worth celebrating on a Memorial Day, just that alone. Thank you. That was beautiful. And you too, Marina. You always do an excellent job over there. She never gets enough credit for what she does, because not everybody can do that. There are a lot of people that can play an instrument, but not people play it with love like she does. So we appreciate that. Our offering, as it comes forward, we want to bless this offering, but we want to bless it from our God mind, from our prosperity, okay? Not from our perception, because our perception goes inside and it says, if I give this, it shortens my pile. And I don't have enough. My pile's too small, too short as it is. But our God mind says, whatever I give, I receive. It's the same thing, because it's a circle. When you give, you receive. You give, you receive. It's not a straight line like our conscious mind sees it. Yep, it's going from that pile to this pile. It's not my pile anymore. Give that up. And if you're trying to give money in that frame of mind, don't give it. Hold on to it until you can give it in love and know that what you give, you receive. So we ask in the name of the Son, Jesus Christ, thank you for this opportunity to receive not only monies and funds to help Unity East Church function and stay alive, but thank you, we receive the gift of life, the gift of healing, the gift of joy, the gift of love that you've given us when you created us. And this we say, amen. Okay, I think we're about at the end here. Do we have any visitors, first-time visitors here? Anybody here for the very first time? No. Well, in that case, let's all go home. let's stand up and do our peace song. But in doing that, let's try take this side and move to the center, and let's make a circle around the chairs in that so that we have a concentric circle instead of this zigzagging and all that kind of stuff. Let's give that a try and see what happens if we have enough. If not, we can always move everybody to the center aisle and make our circle lightweight. Yeah, let's do that. If you want, just go right up the aisle and connect. There you go. Yeah. That way we don't have any short circuits. We're all fully powered. Ready?
Now there is peace on earth, and it has begun with me. Now there is peace on earth, a peace that was meant to be. With God as Creator, family all are we. Now we walk with each other in perfect harmony. Now peace begins with me, and this be my moment now. With every breath partake, let this be my solemn vow, to take each moment and live each moment in peace eternally. Now there is peace on earth, and it has begun with me.
Amen. That was strong, a strong finish. It's always good. And we like to say thank you for this Memorial Day, because we're memorializing the end of our perceptions, our human consciousness, our ego. We'll let that slide. We'll just memorialize and say good riddance, while the rest of us memorialize those souls that have moved on in service to our country and in service to us to protect our freedoms and our lifestyle. And we say together, the light of God surrounds us. The love of God enfolds us. The power of God protects us. The presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well. Now you can hug somebody.
Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Thank you.